I am so excited to be here today with the lovely Lucinda Miller. She's the Nature Doc and she's going to help us and answer some questions about babies' tummies and nutrition and the huge role that does play in their sleep and their well-being. So Lucinda, it's so great to be with you.
Well, it's wonderful to meet you at last and welcome to my home.
You're welcome.
I hope that we're going to have a wonderful chat.
Definitely.
About all things tummy.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, so it would be really good to explore a little bit more about what's going on with babies in those early weeks and early months. Some take to their feeding more easily than others. Mm-hmm. And understanding why some babies may be experiencing more discomfort in their tummies than others.
Absolutely. So, I mean, one of the big things to look out for, obviously, is tongue tie. Mm-hmm. Because if a child's not latching on properly,
yeah,
then they're going to not get a sufficient amount of feed, mm-hmm, and they're going to probably be a bit hungrier. They're often not able to get the hind milk, which is the really nutritious milk. Mm. So that's a very key thing to look out for. Secondly, some just do take in more gas and, mm-hmm, they have more bubbly tummies. And that's often to do with their gut microbiome, so the bacteria in their tummies, which can be passed on from mum to child.
Okay.
And if that's a little bit out of sync,
yeah,
then maybe what we find is that they don't digest the milk as effectively as others.
Mm.
Some babies are new, are born very early, so they have an underdeveloped gut.
Mm.
Other kids just take longer for their guts to develop and it's just harder for them to digest the milk.
Mm.
Some of them we find do have food sensitivities, and there are lots of reasons behind that, which I think we'll probably chat about later.
Yeah.
But we find that actually even when a baby's being fully breastfed, that they have a situation where maybe the eggs their mother's eating or,
yeah,
the milk, mm, or even garlic or something like that is upsetting them.
Yeah.
And so sometimes it's a process of elimination and working out what those triggers are.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes going back to that microbiome concept, it's that they don't have the right bacteria in the gut and they need a baby probiotic, and there's been, mm, quite a lot of research into how probiotics can help with things like colic and sore, mm-hmm, tummies and so forth. So that's something that people sometimes do. And sometimes it's just purely soothing them and making,
yeah,
sure that they're feeding efficiently, feeding regularly during the day,
mm,
and not getting that build-up of gas,
mm-hmm,
over the day.
How about when, you see, I've seen this before with babies that are clearly hungry, they want to take their milk, but you get that sort of back arching, fussing,
mm,
like you can tell there's a discomfort,
mm,
around actually taking that milk on. But you can see they are hungry, so it's not like you're trying to feed a baby when they don't want it. They,
no,
want it, but it hurts, that kind of thing. What could be going on there?
I see that a lot, not just in newborns, but also later on with the fussy eaters,
mm,
in that they're kind of, you can see they're really hungry, and then,
mm,
they take one mouthful or one sip of the milk,
mm,
and it's sort of, they go, oh. And I found that just kids generally prefer not to eat than to have a sore tummy. It's almost like,
mm-hmm,
that's their default. So,
yeah.
And of course, if it's uncomfortable, they go, no, that's not right. Because they don't know what they want, but they,
mm-hmm,
know what is wrong.
Yeah.
But they don't know what is right,
mm-hmm,
for them right now. So, yes, it's fascinating to see. And I think that sometimes it is because they have got a lot of acid in their stomach.
Mm-hmm.
And there are things you can do. From about a month, you can give them sips of fennel tea.
Oh, wow. Okay.
And that's very soothing. It sort of helps with the gas. It,
yeah,
helps to settle.
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of people have fennel tea after supper in the evening, or even chamomile,
yeah,
tea,
mm,
you know, to settle their tummies before they go to bed. So this is very helpful for the children as well.
Amazing.
So it doesn't need to be very much. And,
mm,
it's, you just cool it down. Some,
mm,
people just cool it down with ice cubes. So it's, you know, very, you know, just totally room temperature.
Mm-hmm.
And just little sips of that can really help.
Help to relieve the,
yeah,
pain.
And also things like the baby massage,
mm-hmm,
having a good bath routine.
Yeah.
All very relaxed, maybe a little bit of chamomile in the, mm, bath even.
Because if they are uncomfortable, it's then going to lead on into bedtime and then,
mm,
bedtime routine, and you get that disruption into the sleep as well. So it doesn't necessarily mean there's something wrong medically. It could just be purely the discomfort then.
I mean, I think the doctors are very good at spotting the big medical things, and,
yeah,
really they are usually really quite serious,
mm-hmm,
when there are medical issues,
mm,
and often involve an operation.
Yeah.
Or medication, or even a different milk.
Mm.
But you had a brilliant interview with Adam Fox,
mm,
who's a pediatric allergy specialist, and it was fascinating to hear how his approach is. And his approach seemed to be that the more the child cried, the more likely it was going to be an allergy. Mm-hmm. But they're not actually doing any blood tests as such. They're just sort of going by behaviours. So I think this is where the mother's instinct is so important, because actually if your child is crying all the time, there is something going on, and they, you know, you need to speak to someone who knows what might be going on or can be and work it out what's going on.
I think sometimes as well with that early stage discomfort, their tummies are so tiny and they're growing so quickly, and actually they sometimes do just outgrow that and they settle down and things do come together, and then you know that there wasn't an allergy in that case. But yeah, really helpful to identify it. So are there any other things that we can look for, actions or moves that a baby may do if there is something maybe to spot allergy wise or anything like that?
So in terms of sleep, what we often spot is that, you know, the baby won't settle, they won't go on their back or they won't go on their side, or they just feel really uncomfortable as they're sort of upright. Another thing that we see a lot is that they curl up in a little ball like this, as if they're really in pain. We see that in older children as well. But another thing to look out for is the state of their nappies. Okay. How often are they doing a poo? Because if they're really constipated, they could well be in pain. It just may be that. Or if they've got very loose bowels and they're pooing 6, 8, 10 times a day, that could be an issue. If you're seeing mucus or blood in the nappy, then that could be an issue. If you're seeing, once they're weaned, lots of undigested food, so you've got sort of orange poo coming out when they've eaten carrot or green when they've had broccoli, then they're not digesting and absorbing that. So there could be something more going on. And that's what I guess what we do more in our clinic is see the kids slightly later on, as in, you know, from weaning onwards, where mothers just say, look, the nappies are not right. They're not sleeping. They just feel like they're not extracting the nutrition they should be from what they're eating.
Yeah. So there's a lot to be said about identifying the poo.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Excellent.
Being a poo doctor.
Yeah. No, that it makes total sense though. And you do know when something's not right, when they're not going, or you're getting rabbit stoppings, or like you said, really loose. I've experienced both ends of the scale with my children. So
yeah, no, we've experienced poonamis.
But yeah.
We've had puke-thons, we've had the full lot.
Yeah, full works. There's a lot to be said for that. So is there anything we can do to tell the difference between a child who doesn't want to be put down on their back because they want the cuddles with mummy or daddy, which is totally understandable, and they're crying to say, no, how dare you put me down, to a child who is genuinely in pain? How can we spot the difference there?
Well, what I think you can do usually is that you can distract them quite easily. If it's something, you know, of course they want to be with mummy, but they're so excited about the world. And if you can, you know, shake a rattle or have a little toy, or they're out and about and they can see something in the distance, if they can be distracted, then that's usually because they really just wanted to be with mummy.
Okay.
But I think that if they really are lying down and they're crying and crying and crying and they just won't settle or cannot be distracted, then there's probably a tummy pain.
Pain going on.
And as I said, there are various things you can do, everything from the tummy massage through and baby massage through to the fennel tea, through seeing a cranial osteopath and just checking to see if everything's aligned. Because sometimes that can be out of sync as well.
Especially through challenging births. I think even a challenging birth can lead to things being out of line, probably not just in the skull, but in the tummy as well, I imagine.
Absolutely. I mean, I've seen some really wonderful changes in children's guts, gut function, just from seeing a cranial osteopath a couple
That's
of times.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
Wow.
And the sleep and the poo and everything just seems more normal.
That's really good.
And often they're born sort of on, you know, if they've had a stressful birth, they're born sort of on high alert. So it's like this born with fear in the world.
Yeah.
And again, it's very calming. And I think this is where the massage and the bath routines and just being very calm around them makes such a difference.
Definitely. If you're frantic all the time, they're going to pick up on that. We always talk to parents about that. Just put out there the vibes that you want to see from your child. It definitely helps.
It's so hard though, because as a new mum, you are very anxious. I mean, the worry button just gets turned on as soon as you're pregnant first time round. And it's really hard to rein that in because it's all unknown. Your life has changed so dramatically going from probably working full time, having a bit of money, you know, to go on nice holidays, and suddenly going, oh my gosh, I'm never going to have a penny in my bank account ever again.
This is my life now.
This is my life. I'm not sleeping. They're not sleeping. I had an awful situation where my babies were sleeping, but I wasn't.
Okay.
And for 2 or 3 years, I hardly slept because I was on this high alert. I was on this sort of anxious, you know, like worry about trying to pack everything in. I was trying to be too busy working and juggling kids. And it was really hard. And I got myself incredibly run down. So I think that we bring a lot of that with us, and it's very hard not to do that. And I think we're so lucky these days because we have people who can, you know, meditation's become more popular, we can do yoga apps at home when the babies are sleeping. There are things that we all now can do where we don't have to spend a penny, but we can still look after ourselves a bit better. And I think this postnatal depletion and anxiety and so forth is such a huge factor for not just us, but also for the babies.
It is, definitely. We need to be able to look after ourselves in order to be a good job and look after a baby. If you're a depleted mess, how can you then do everything you need to do for your baby? Actually, we see lots of mums who are really depleted, not just through the lack of sleep, but also because of a lack of nutrition. Now, I completely understand that your expertise is in children, but nutrition generally for mums, can we grab things that will help sustain our energy as a new mum, a busy mum who has her hands full, that can't spend hours in the kitchen?
So we're very passionate in our clinic. We do a lot of work postnatally with the mums, because we've seen so many cases where it's really gone horribly wrong, and people have ended up in psychiatric wards. Yeah. And you just think, and what's extraordinary is almost every case, when it's been very extreme, has been the underlying problem is to do with nutrition and health. So, for instance, one lady that I see, she actually turned out that she had a hyperactive thyroid.
Wow.
And that is what sent her into that psychiatric mode.
Wow.
Because she was so anxious, she wasn't sleeping, she was just on hyper alert. Then we had another lovely lady who, again, she had turned out she was anemic, and iron is incredibly important for your mood. And again, she'd gone into this OCD anxiety mode, and she had, you know, her mum and her sisters all looking after the baby because she wasn't able to function. And literally as soon as she started taking iron, she was a different person. And I would love at that 6 week check, that postnatal six-week check, for the mums to all have a blood test and just check the basics, vitamin D, ferritin, thyroid, because these are the things that go out of sync a lot at this point. You know, a lot of people have big bleeds when they give birth.
Yep.
Often you're inside a lot feeding, so you're not getting the sunshine and the vitamin D.
Yep.
And very often the thyroid does get thrown out. And I think that those things would be really beneficial, and that's the sort of thing that we do in our clinic. We just make sure that there's a quick blood test they can do, which we can organise privately, and often that gives us really good clues on how to get them back on track.
It's amazing. It's so important.
But this is where, food-wise, the things that you can do, I mean, really nutritious foods that contain a lot of these foods are, I mean, meat is important, and everyone says, oh, we shouldn't eat too much red meat these days, but actually postnatally it's really important to have quite a lot of things like steak, lamb chops, bolognese, etc. If people are vegetarian, to have a lot more veg, a lot of lentils, black beans, kidney beans, which are full of iron, even chocolate, you know, that's good. Actually, dark chocolate is quite nutritious. Yay. It's like, you know, Greek yogurt. All these things contain things like zinc, which are very important for the brain, and lots of B vitamins. So I think it's, and then also another thing which I think is great are Epsom salt baths. So you put magnesium in the bath, and you sort of, this is when your mummies usually have a time of the day where they can relax a little bit. Maybe the kids have just gone to bed.
Yeah.
Maybe around 9 o'clock. I always find about 9 o'clock I'd have a long bath and then get ready to do those night feeds all night.
Yeah.
And I'd have an Epsom salt bath, and that really helped me put me in a more relaxed state. And I think it did help a lot.
I didn't realise it had those effects actually beyond beyond the physical benefits of that. That's really interesting.
So it's very sweet. My daughter, she always said, I have lovely dreams whenever I've had an Epsom salt bath.
Oh.
And she's very sporty now. She's 15, so she's older now. But still now her default when she comes home is to have an Epsom salt bath. Amazing. Yeah, so it's her sort of thing.
That's a great tip.
Yeah, I know, it's really cool. But I think also, you know, obviously, if you're not allergic, carrying a bunch of nuts around is really important. Things like cashew nuts have lots of magnesium in them, which help you relax. I think, you know, walnuts are the ultimate brain food. They've got a lot of omega-3 in there.
Yeah.
And so those are really good too. So those are easy. And seeds, some things like munchie seeds and so forth, pumpkin seeds, sunflower seeds. They're all things that you can grab and go.
And have in your handbag.
Have in your handbag. Exactly, because actually I know one-armed cooking is really hard.
Definitely.
And I used to say to people, you know, before you have the baby, just chop up masses and masses of veg and put them in the freezer so you've got them. Things like onions. I mean, trying to chop an onion with a baby in your arm, it's just impossible. But if you've got them, you can just chuck them into your frying pan or a saucepan and then, you know, start making things from scratch. So it's little things like that. And, and you know, little florets and peas and carrots and everything sort of all chopped up so you can just chuck them in.
Yeah.
And that's my other sort of tip.
Keep things,
so there's always lots of veg around. You don't have to think, is it fresh or not fresh or can I find a knife? Because I had this fear of holding a knife and holding a baby and I just thought
two don't go together very well, do they?
It was really scary. I had some moments where it really gave me the fear. So so I think, you know, and if you have a child that won't sit, you know, won't sit in their little chair watching you because they're uncomfortable. Or they don't sleep well in the day, you don't get that opportunity.
Yeah, you can find yourself that the whole day has gone and you haven't had a chance. And and we allow ourselves to get depleted. We'll feed the child and that's top priority. But if we can have those things on hand so that we can stay energized. And keep our spirits up too, because it can be a lonely and tough time as a new parent.
Yeah. So it's just making everything as quick as possible, but as nutritious as possible. And whether you just live on stir fries, it's okay.
It's not forever.
No, it's really not.
So with moving on from the baby stage and some of those discomforts, then onto weaning.
Yes.
And we all want to get our little ones to train their taste buds to want to have the good nutritious foods. How can we do that really well?
Well, the first thing that I find is if you just make that vow to yourself that you're going to cook from scratch as much as possible. I mean, there are so many tempting pouches in the supermarkets where you could grab food and just squeeze it onto a spoon or even squeeze it straight into their mouth. And the trouble is the majority of those, and some companies are really good and they're getting better all the time, but the majority of them are pure fruit. So I have seen pouches where it's chicken and broccoli. You think, yay! And it's 90% apple.
Wow.
With a tiny bit of chicken and a tiny bit of broccoli.
That's so misleading.
It is, unfortunately. And I think it will change. And as I said, better brands are coming out with it. But even those, a lot of that food's been made a year, 2 years ago.
Wow.
It sat being cooked for 6 to 8 hours.
Yeah.
So it's not sort of as fresh as you do at home. So this is why doing it from scratch is very important, but also to train the taste buds.
Yeah.
So even if you are doing, say, apple puree, every apple will taste slightly different.
Yeah.
And it might be that there's a tiny lump in there, it's slightly sweeter, slightly tartar, because as the year progresses and, you know, the different apples, you know, the different brands come in, you know, the different varieties and so forth, I think you get this slight difference.
Yeah.
And it's just, you've cooked it for a bit longer or shorter. Yeah. It's just a slightly different texture. And so even with something sweet like fruit, you can still be a great variety.
Yeah.
And as I said, with apples, you could get a jazz apple, a gala apple, a Braeburn apple. You've got all the different apples as well. So it doesn't have to just be one. And I think it's really important to try and mix everything up as much as possible. But also you have the opportunity to get more veg in really early. And what's wonderful, so my eldest is 18 and the guidelines at that point were very strict about when you introduce foods because of potential allergens. So sort of you can't do strawberries or prawns or anything till they're about two. I mean, it was it was really crazy.
Yeah.
But now they've realised, and the top paediatric allergists have all coming in with saying, get as many different foods in as possible, as early on as possible.
Okay.
So obviously you introduce one food at a time because looking for allergies in case there is a problem. And a lot of babies have problems with foods you wouldn't even imagine, like banana or avocado. They can have quite serious reactions to.
Wow.
So you never know what it might be. So you always go one by one. But as soon as they've had it at least twice, you can think, yep, that's tick. So you can have your tick list. You think, okay, apples are okay, bananas are okay, kale's
so
okay.
So twice is safe.
Once so basically twice. The second time you are exposed to a food, you get that reaction if you're going to have an allergic reaction.
Okay.
It's very rarely the first first time. And it, some mums will say, well, they haven't had banana before, but it, you may have eaten a lot of bananas when you're breastfeeding them, so they have had banana. Do you know what I mean? So, okay. It's more that. So it's almost ticking off the list. And then mm-hmm. once you know they can have, I know, carrot, sweet potato, apple, you can then start mixing it all up and do your own combinations. Mm. And that's where it gets really exciting. And then very much encourage things like nut butters, seed butters. I think the core is no salt, mm-hmm. no honey, and nothing they can choke on. So anything that you potentially could choke on, blend it all up and it should be fine. Yeah. So that's where you wouldn't ever give a whole nut. Mm. But a nut butter or ground almonds or something like that is absolutely fine. And this is where you can get really crafty with lots of nutritious food.
Yeah.
And you can get you can get all sorts of grains in, quinoa, buckwheat, millet, teff, amaranth. I mean, these slightly different ones, which are all you can get in the supermarkets now. Mm-hmm. It's actually really easy to get these different grains. Yeah. And they all blend in beautifully into the mush. And then you slowly start introducing the finger food as well. And I'm very much into the dual approach of the baby-led weaning and the mush.
Yeah.
Because I think the two together work really well. Yeah. I mean, my eldest wasn't the most coordinated when he was little, and a lot of it went in the dog. So, you know, I just really feel that, gosh, he would have starved if I hadn't given him some puree.
Yeah.
And also I wanted them all to really enjoy things like fish pies and shepherd's pies and the sort of sloppy food as well as the crunchy food.
Yeah.
And I think this is where it can all go wrong around the sort of 10 to 18 month mark, is they become very independent mm-hmm. and they go, no, I want to feed myself, but they're not quite coordinated enough to do that. So they want to pick everything up.
Mm.
Of course, that tends to be the dry food.
Yeah.
And this is where you get the dry, crunchy kids come in and they end up only eating pizza and nuggets or whatever it is in the long term. So you go from this glorious organic purees to pizza and nuggets. And you think, how did that happen? And so we're sort of, that's what my book, The Good Stuff, is all about, is helping with that transition.
Yeah.
So that actually they end up eating everything.
That's brilliant. I love that. And I think also it's encouraging because to cook from scratch for a baby or a toddler that you think this is going to end up on the floor can be a bit disheartening.
Oh, it's huge.
But if you're going to cook that food and you can use those ingredients to make a meal for yourself, for the family, but then puree up the baby's portion, it just makes the whole thing feel a lot more worthwhile and a lot more, you're going to take a lot more boxes than just having a little one that rejects it and is soul destroying that you've gone to all this effort. So I think that's great as well when you do that from scratch.
I used to sit down with the kids, even if I wasn't hungry at lunchtime, and eat something with them.
Yeah.
And I'll never forget a friend turning up, said, what's he eating? And I said, oh, he's having guinea fowl. And they went, what? And this was a 9 month old baby.
Brilliant.
And I said, well, that's what we had last night. And I just made sure there wasn't any salt in it.
Yeah.
And I've mushed it up with, whatever it was, swede and broccoli or something. And he was chomping it down. He thought it was great. I said, you know, it's basically chicken, but it's got a slightly different taste.
Yeah.
So it's all about getting the variety in.
Yeah.
And so many people, you know, things like peppers, for instance.
Yeah.
Most kids like red peppers mm-hmm. because they're the sweetest,
mm-hmm.
but try yellow peppers and orange peppers.
Yeah.
And actually those three colours are all very important at building the microbiome, this good bacteria in the gut. So the variety, all those pigments in the food are the things that build the immune system.
And you can mix them into lots of things, can't you?
Oh, loads. I mean, peppers are really useful.
Yeah.
All you have to do is just roast them to get the skins off
mm-hmm.
because they often don't like the skins. It's that sort of thing, a bit bitter, but mm-hmm. they're lovely and sweet inside and they puree up really beautifully. And you can make pestos and all sorts of things with it.
Yeah.
So it's great. So all it is trying to get as many different veg in as possible.
Yeah.
And you know, kale is actually very easy to mush up. Courgette's incredibly flexible for baby food.
Mm.
So I think courgette went in a lot of my kids' foods because it's kind of, it mushes up. It's quite liquid.
Yeah.
So it makes everything of quite a nice texture. So I did it with sort of salmon and celeriac or butter beans. And you can bring in all these different pulses and things. And it does slowly, you know, it's getting that. And then, as I said, it's that transition when they're a bit more independent and mm-hmm. they are going to say no to lots of things. And that's where we do with we have the 3-spoon approach. Do you know this?
No, tell me.
So what happens is they're sitting there and you give them 2 spoons.
Okay.
And so they're playing with them, and often they drop 1 spoon, but then they'll grab, I don't know, a a cracker or something. Mm-hmm. But then you're also feeding them because they're sort of distracted.
Brilliant.
And it's hilarious because they think they're being really independent with their with their spoon, and you're still feeding them.
Yeah, excellent. Actually, I remember my son having two spoons. He loved holding two spoons, having something to hold.
Exactly.
There did still need to be. So I think quite naturally we did that because otherwise nothing would go in here.
Exactly. So that's a really important part of that time in their lives.
Mm.
Because these kids, you know, as I said, they just want to say, look, I'm a little grown up now and I can tell you what I'm eating. But actually 3 seconds later, they suddenly go, oh my God, I'm starving.
Mm.
And they don't know how to express that because, of course, they were playing. It was fun.
Yeah.
And it's just sustaining them. It's getting enough food in so that they will sleep through their nap and they're not going to be grazing all day.
Definitely.
Because that's the other thing. So they can be sitting in a buggy when you're shopping, living off rice cakes, and they're not eating a proper meal.
Mm.
So the snacks are a big thing as well, which can be... I mean, a snack should really be a tiny snack.
Mm-hmm.
And there was a brilliant... it's just one of those visuals you get. There was an interview I was listening to a few months ago, and this... lady was talking about her daughter who was 18 months old and said, well, the trouble is, you know, if I give her a biscuit, that's the size of a bin lid.
Yeah.
You know, in terms of how tiny she is.
Mm.
So that is actually a really enormous thing. That's pretty much her stomach, is that cookie.
Yeah.
So to think of it like that, because everyone thinks, oh, it's just a biscuit.
Mm.
But it's not quite big for them, and it might be impacting on them what they eat at lunch.
Yeah.
Or at tea.
Mm. Questions that you touched on about salt earlier and making sure that wasn't... Is there an age when salt is useful or suitable? Where does salt fit in?
So from a medical perspective, they say that you shouldn't have any salt until you're a year old.
Mm-hmm.
You shouldn't then just plough in with lots of salt. I think it's one of those things that gradually happens. So it's, for instance, you would buy salted butter.
Mm.
You know, or something like that. You know what I mean? It was sort of, but you wouldn't really want to start adding salt.
No.
Because it can affect their kidneys and there is salt toxicity that can occur. So you just want to build up very slowly. But I think what happens so often is people go from, as I said, the home cooked baby mush to suddenly buying lots of food from a year.
Mm.
And obviously, you know, anything, you know, like a pizza's got a lot of salt in it, a lot of the pasta sauces have got a lot of salt in it. So actually you could be overloading your child quite quickly.
Mm.
So kidney disease is one thing to look out for.
Yeah.
But also if your family have a history of high blood pressure,
mm-hmm.
then you have to be careful.
Mm-hmm.
But what's really interesting is that I'm talking about older kids really, rather than the tinies, but a lot of families do have low blood pressure.
Mm.
And actually a little bit of salt can make all the difference to their energy levels.
Yeah.
So obviously that's something that needs to be assessed by a professional.
Mm.
But it's still something to think about.
Yeah.
And I think there are some mums, I mean, you know, they've got sort of 12-year-olds, they say, we still don't put salt in their children's food, and their children are absolutely depleted and exhausted because they're sporty and they've been sweating out all the salt in their through their sport and not replacing it.
Mm. So there is a place for it, but it's
and again really... they find that something like sea salt or Himalayan salt, which have a few more minerals in there,
mm-hmm.
are better for you than say table salt, which is pretty man-made. And so and again in the processed food, so the big thing that I found in my research, my practice, is that if you want to have healthy, happy kids, what you do is you try and cook from scratch as much as possible, because the ultra-processed foods really don't have very high-quality ingredients in there.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's like the salt. They don't choose the sea salt. They'll choose the table salt.
Yeah.
The flour will be very processed rather than the lovely whole grain.
Mm.
And that's the difference, is that you can put... You know what ingredients you're putting in.
Mm-hmm.
But also they add other ingredients to the food. So there are a lot of preservatives, thickeners, emulsifiers, etc., to make everything pour beautifully or whatever, or not stick together, so it's got a longer shelf life. And those things are the things they're thinking are associated with all the big things going on in health these days, all the modern diseases like the type 2 diabetes, cardiovascular disease, the obesity and so forth. It's the ultra processing, it's the extra ingredients in the food. So again, I don't think there's anything wrong with eating a pizza, but try and make it from scratch if you can. Even if it's elements of it, think I'm just going to get good quality, I know, organic cheese, make my own tomato sauce, maybe I'll buy the base because that's easy, but let's get a good quality one. You know, you sort of slowly kind of make, you try and do bits, even if you can't do the whole lot yourself.
Yeah, and I think in a world where we often, speed and convenience can sometimes overtake, so actually it's taking that time to think, well, hang on, no, quality over speed. I'm a big fan of prepping and doing things in batches if you know that you can't be in the kitchen several times a day every day. Do you think that batch preparing meals, I think things last longer in the fridge than we think, but what life do things have nutritionally if you are going to prep for the week ahead, for example?
Well, anything that's frozen quite quickly after cooking will preserve all its nutrients. So actually,
best to freeze.
So if you can, I'd say probably 3 or 4 days in the fridge maximum. You know, if you're thinking, I'm going to do a tomato sauce and we're going to, I know, make turn part of it into a bolognese one night and part of it into, I know, tomato pasta with lentils or something another night, or whatever it might be, that's fine. But if you think, actually, I'm not sure what our plans are this week, and, you know, we're going to someone's for tea on Tuesday, and, you know, then put it in the freezer. And you can always get it out, and it defrosts really quickly. So the best thing is to freeze, and it's brilliant. The freezer is our, you know, is every mum's dream, and it's, you know, if you don't have a freezer, then invest in one.
It's essential, isn't it?
I had a lovely mum. She's got about 5 or 6 kids, and they said, and they were, she said, I'm just driving me crazy about all this cooking. I said, where's your freezer? She said, I haven't got one. She had a, you know, tiny one in the fridge. And I said, have you got any space in your garage? And I said, if you're going to do one thing, get a freezer.
Big, deep freeze.
And she's just like happy mummy now. Because I think, you know, I said, look, you can freeze. So, for instance, you can freeze muffins, freeze flapjacks, brownies. You can do the everything ahead. You know, it's not just everything. I think a lot of people think about freezing main meals or soups, but they don't think about all the baked things as well. Pancakes, waffles.
Yeah.
It's great. You can just pull them out of the freezer and put them in the toaster.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
What I did a lot with the kids is, we've got quite a long school run, so I grab muffins out of the freezer, and by the time we got to school, they defrosted.
Brilliant.
Yeah, it was easy.
And
you
it's going to be fresher.
It was as instant as you could, exactly.
Yeah,
so it's all possible. And so I'm big into batch cooking as well. And Sundays are often a day where, you know, you're doing a roast anyway, so you make a stock, you make, I don't know, you just, and we sort of tend to either, we live off the leftovers, but anything sort of extra.
Yeah.
And I'm often doing, I know, 6 cans of tomatoes rather than 2.
Yeah.
In a, you know, so that you've got extra in the freezer. And then it's just easy.
Yeah.
And as I said, that could be pizza topping. It could be anything, really. Salsa.
Yeah.
You could just change. It's just actually real, just being quite efficient in the freezer and writing on the label what you've put in there.
Yeah. Yeah.
And especially if you've got kids with allergies, sometimes you've got to have, you know, this is, I know, Ethan's one, this is Jack's one, because one's got, I know, dairy and one hasn't, or whatever it might be.
Just being organised, isn't it?
Yeah.
I think if you have got that busy life, so many mums are working and juggling, picking children up from childcare and all over the place, but to take that time, make that time and take that time to get prepared and be organised buys you the time for the rest of the week.
I think, you see, when you do all these things, then your kids do sleep better, they have better immune systems, there's less stress going on at school. So the fascinating study, one of the studies I drew on in my book, it was talking about kids that eat more fruit and veg are more likely to be more self-confident, more curious, more creative, but also less likely to be bullied. So all these big things that happen in at schools where mums are worried about their kids could boil down to what they're eating. I'm not saying it's everything.
That's
of course,
amazing.
There will be other major issues, so it's not just one thing.
No.
But it's still really interesting data.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And I think that that's really important to think, because a lot of people say, but why 5 a day? You know, we get all this sort of thing. You're like, why? And everyone, I guess, thinks, oh, well, maybe they'll be slimmer. Maybe they'll have better teeth. Mm. I don't know. People don't really get why the five a day.
Yeah.
And
five, it's healthier.
It's healthier, but what does that really
what does
mean?
That mean? What does that mean?
But when you're looking at, you know, actually kids are, yes, they are slimmer, they are brighter, but they are also doing better at school.
Mm-hmm. Well, it must impact their focus, though, mm. their concentration skills, their ability to listen and absorb their learnings, which you can't do when you're depleted. So surely that's... it's hugely important.
And with, there was a study again on omega-3, mm. which is in fish, so oily fish like mm-hmm. sardines and salmon and yeah. so forth. And it's so important. It basically helps to develop the child's central nervous system. And there was one study on bedwetting and, yeah. you know, 4 months of taking fish oil made these kids dry through the night. Which
wow.
is, and you know, imagine how many kids can't go on sleepovers, they're yeah. embarrassed, they're still in nappies, aged 8, 9, 10 at night.
Yeah.
You know, and this could be transformative mm-hmm. to them and their self-confidence, their self-esteem. And then also great studies on their performance at school, so reading, writing, mm. And being able to concentrate and working memory, all yeah. again linked to mm. nutrition. And you just think, if you can just do these little things at home,
yeah. yeah,
and it is tough sometimes, and occasionally you just go, oh, but it's okay not to do it all the time. And I mm. think that's another thing which is so important. People really beat themselves up, think, oh God, everyone was in such a mood, I had to grab a pizza. I think that's why they're there. That's why we have convenience yeah. foods. It's for that emergency.
Yeah.
As long as you don't do it the next
it's
night and the next
the
night and it becomes your mm. norm, mm. then it's okay.
Yeah.
And
you don't have to, it doesn't have to be all or nothing. You
no.
can do a good amount of home cooking. I think it's fascinating as well, that, obviously from the sleep perspective, we see, we look after people with behavioural sleep problems, not medical,
mm.
And we see the difference in the behavioural and the medical, but then bringing nutritional in as another factor, like you were just saying about learning and school and focus and concentration, how it's not always behavioural or medical, actually nutrition, which is completely holistic, can be the solution. What foods would you say would really help with sleep, that would be conducive to good sleep, that release all those good things that we need for sleep?
Well, one of the things is milk. And this is why babies have milk before bed,
yeah.
you know, and even toddlers and older children. So a nice warm drink
mm.
before bed is really important. And things like also, you know, the older children, things like chamomile tea or mm-hmm. the fennel tea, again, are very relaxing.
Yeah.
So a nice warm drink is really important. Mm. And I think a good bed routine is very important mm-hmm. as well, but that's not really so much food.
Mm-hmm.
But oats are particularly
okay.
conducive to sleep.
Yep.
So if your child says, "Mummy, I'm hungry," just mm-hmm. before bed,
yeah.
give them a couple of oat cakes.
Yeah.
Or maybe, you know, a drink made from oat milk, or even a little bowl of porridge or some mm-hmm. oats would be a good idea. So those are, so it's like, you know, so if you've got milk and oats together, like a little porridgey thing, that would be
yeah.
quite a good idea.
Mm.
So those are sort of foods that are really good. And to avoid anything that's going to really pick them up.
Mm.
So caffeine. Mm. Now, most children don't have caffeine, you don't think, but actually chocolate is quite caffeinated.
Mm-hmm.
And very buzzy foods, you know, some of the ones with artificial colours and sweeteners,
mm.
some of the, you know, sugar-free jellies. I mean, there's no actual food in there.
No.
They're just chemicals. So
yeah.
there are things like that. Some of the puddings
mm-hmm.
after supper can be an issue.
Mm.
And I think that's where you just got to watch and observe. Because there are some children who can eat anything and
mm-hmm.
it doesn't affect their sleep. They're bulletproof.
Yeah.
But there are others who are incredibly sensitive.
Yep.
And it's saying, yes, I know it says in the rule book, whatever that rule book is, that, you know, a child should have this at a certain time of the day. But actually just observe, does your child react more to things?
Mm-hmm.
And what did they have? What was the pattern?
Yeah.
So, for instance, if they've woken up 3 times in a week,
mm-hmm.
look back and see what they had at dinner time.
Mm-hmm.
And think, what, you know, and it might be tomatoes.
Yeah.
You know, it could be a food that's triggering this.
Yeah.
It's just making their tummy upset at night.
Mm.
Another thing with the older children, which is a pretty gross subject, but it is very, very, very common, are little threadworms.
Okay.
And we often find the kids that are waking up around 11 o'clock at night.
Yep.
And they sort of scream out and they're often the mummy, I need you, whatever.
Mm.
So it's not sort of the middle of the night. It's
mm-hmm.
sort of almost like when the parents are going to bed.
Yeah.
just check them for threadworm, because it's so common in nurseries and things now, and it's so easily treated with Ovex over the counter. But it is a big disruptor of sleep, and the number of kids that come to our clinic, and I say to them, do you ever get a wriggle in your bottom? And they go, and I go, mummy, go and treat them. and treat them with Ovex. And often it's just like, you know, different story.
Wow.
Different story of sleep. So there are little things like that can really disrupt them. So to look out for these things. But as I said, it tends to be once they're at nursery or at school.
Yeah.
That's where they catch them. Or the older siblings, if they share baths.
Yeah. There's that culture of puddings. And
yes,
even at nursery, even right from the baby stage, when they're giving them their purees, they're kind of giving them their mains and then their puddings. What's the best advice around that? What should we, ideally, from a nutritional point of view, be giving and avoiding with puddings?
So, yes, it's very much... When I was weaning my children, it was very much in every single book I read. It was like, you know, you have the savoury, then you have the sweet. And I did question that a lot. And I felt that actually, yes, sometimes they get bored of what they're eating and they need a distraction, they need something different. So I think this is where you often see babies now with divided plates.
Yeah.
Where you have lots of different things. So you might have, you know, scrambled egg and some avocado and some tomatoes and, I don't know, some blueberries or something. Just to sort of shake it up and change things around. So I do feel that sometimes they do need two things, but they don't necessarily have to be two sweet things. They could just be two, it could be soup.
Yeah.
And then a stewy thing or a risotto-y thing or a pasta-y thing. So it doesn't have to be something sweet. And I think for them to expect every time to get something sweet is a little different. And what I try and do is with all the food is to make sure that every single mouthful is so nutritious that they get really full quite quickly. So they're less likely to want the sweet puddingy stuff.
The sweet things. It kind of leads me on to a question when they are actually a little bit older. So when you have children, and I know I'm not the only one who experiences this, with school holidays, and they just seem hungry all day, and you think, well, how do you last at school with school food, you know, mealtime, lunchtime? At home, you just want to eat constantly. And, you know, children of an age where they want to grab those snacks that have zero nutritional value.
Lots of carbs, basically.
Of course, they're growing and, you know, they may have hunger spikes. But what can mums do with that sort of age group where they're hungry all the time? I'm hungry.
So usually what it is because they're eating too many carbs.
Okay.
So they're not satiated, they're not full. So I think what we've been sent messages for so long is fat is bad. Gosh, we shouldn't be eating this, we shouldn't be eating that. And of course, everyone hones in not to healthy snacks being quite sugary and quite carby. So the number of times people say, well, they have loads of snacks. They have breadsticks, they have fruit, they have raisins. And I go, those are all sugar. So what about the fat? What about the protein? So for instance, I'll say, well, why don't you serve it with peanut butter? So, you know, so you dip some apple in some peanut butter or some cashew butter or almond butter. Why don't you serve, say, rice cakes or oat cakes with some hummus? What about, you know, some cheese with it? And that is obviously got the protein and the fat, and it stabilizes, it makes that snack much more filling for that moment. So they're less cravey. And also with the school holidays, is it's also quite easy to go, well, everyone gets up at slightly different times, breakfast is less of a focus somehow. So again, thinking, I'm just going to make a big spread, and whether they come down at 6, 8, 9, depending on age groups, that it's there. So there's pancakes on the table, there's berries, there's nuts, there's milk, there's yogurt, whatever it might be, you know, and you kind of make sure there's always a feast there. And then what I've done with my teens, we've got big exams coming up, is I often leave lots of snacks on the table during the day or in the fridge, so that in sort of see-through some boxes, so they can see what's there. So it might be chopped up fruit, it might be, as I said, dips, that kind of thing. So there's always stuff to eat that's sort of healthy.
Love to live in your house.
Not all the time, I try. I can't say, you know, sometimes, you know, it's not perfect, but there's usually healthy things, whether it's dates or whatever it might be. There's, I try and shake things up. It was really interesting for a while. I kept on buying bananas and they never got eaten. And they said, it's because they weren't on the table, mummy. And they were literally on the side. And of course, as soon as I put them on the table, the bananas just went. So I think it's all having it sort of like in their view.
Definitely. I think that's true of most things. It's, we do the things that right there in front of us. That's really, really helpful. And I think keeping them going, keeping them full. We need carbs.
Sure, of course we all do.
It's getting the right ones, isn't it?
And it's getting that balance. I think I would say that in my experience, in clinic and as a mum, is that kids are so drawn to carbs. And it's just trying to get that balance back.
Yeah.
So, for instance, you know, I'm always chucking in lentils and butter beans and things into sauces, like a tomato sauce and so forth, trying to get a bit of protein because they think, oh, I want carb. But then it's trying to get something else in. And it may not be perfect, may not be quite enough protein, and say, okay, let's get some cheese on. Yeah, that's great. Yeah. You know, we're trying to get more in. And I think that's really, really important.
I love that concept, actually. Yes, it's about sort of adding more things in rather than depleting and taking things away that are bad. It's going, well, actually, if you're going to have the breadstick, what can you have with that that's going to make it far more nutritional, filling,
exactly, and satisfying? Exactly. So maybe you're finding a whole meal breadstick or a spelt one, and they've often got seeds on them now, and then you dip them in hummus and you have a few carrots on the side or some red peppers, and suddenly you've actually got a really healthy snack.
I, Lucinda, have absolutely been loving your book.
And, oh, you're sweet.
And there's still more I want to delve into, and I'm planning on doing that during the school holidays and getting really to grips with it. What can you do if you have made all the mistakes and you have children that are a little bit older who you wish you could go back and retrain their taste buds from the beginning, and you think, if only I did it this way. What's a good way to start to manoeuvre them onto a better path nutritionally?
So it's working out what they do like. Mm-hmm. So, for instance, I think pretty much every child I know likes a brownie.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. So my brownies have got a courgette in there. Yeah. So I'm thinking, okay, so kids who won't eat greens, let's give them and get them to make it at home so they can see it.
Yeah.
And it's a fun activity to do in the holiday. They feel really involved. They feel empowered. Mm. They've seen the photos of it and they go, oh, that looks yummy. Yeah. I really want that. Yeah. And I think that's really important to find things they do like. So things like waffles. Mm-hmm. We've got poppy seeds and carrot grated into there. And there are some muffins, which seem to be the one that on Instagram, I get literally messages every day with my blueberry and banana muffins. And again, they've got a whole courgette in there. They've got some ground almonds. They've got sunflower seeds. So they're just packed with the nutrition.
Yeah, yeah.
But they're also kind of a bit beige.
Yeah.
And, you know, I was trying to get that beige, crunchy side of things.
Yeah.
And I just think that slowly, slowly, they will change. And it's a confidence thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, we're not trying to dupe you into stuff, but, you know, if you're doing... But also, I think what's really important is, as children get older, they actually look to you as their role model.
Mm.
So if you're sitting there scoffing biscuits and not sitting down and having a proper meal with them, then they're going to see that as what an adult does.
Mm-hmm.
So it's, you know, even if you're not hungry, say, look, I'm going to eat later. Mm-hmm. I mean, we really encourage at home, we eat with the kids now, and we just love it, and it's just the most important three times of the day that we do it. It's usually twice a day. It's usually lunch and dinner when they're at home in the holidays. I think sometimes it doesn't work. You know, someone's husband comes back from work really late, or you're coming back. You know, and
children are coming home quite hungry. They're quite little.
So, but generally trying to show that, you know, whenever you can, whether it's Saturday evening, whether it's Sunday lunch, it's all sitting down and having a proper meal and showing that love for food yourselves. Because if you've got a hang up, they've got a hang up. So I think, you know, and also not demonising any food. Obviously, if a child's got an allergy, they're not a nut allergy. You're not going to have nuts around. But they know that. And they know that, but if you say that's very specific to you, there's nothing wrong. So I always say it's not the food's fault. It's your immune system that's decided it's not a good one
for
you.
Not a good match.
exactly. So I think it's really important to emphasise that so that they don't think nuts are poison to other, you know, to others.
Yeah.
But also, you know, even if, you know, you've got very strong views on a certain food that doesn't suit you, you know, a lot of people hate fish. Somehow they were brought up with this overwhelming smell of horrible mackerel or whatever it is, and they've got this fear of fish, but they've got to overcome that somehow and get their kids eating fish. It would be really good.
Yeah.
And I know it can be very, very hard, so a lot of it's here.
It is. And that's true, actually. It's fear. Sometimes it is fear, and I see that with children. They'll look at a food and it's almost like they are afraid a food phobia, because it's scary or it's different or it's the unknown, and just being afraid to even try, that's stressful for parents, because you think, well, please, just a mouthful, you might love it, and it's getting them to overcome that fear of I will.
But what's really important is with them is to say, if they pick it up, that's fantastic. If
great
they
step.
Smell it, that's fantastic. If they put it to their lips, that's even better.
Mm-hmm.
They even put a small, tiny bit in their mouth, incredible.
Mm-hmm.
So all of these steps should be congratulated.
Positive,
exactly,
then, yeah.
And think we are making strides.
Okay.
And it can take 20 times for a child to adapt to a new food.
Mm.
And as I said, when you are a role model at home, so we've always had... So what I did was we sort of had that stage where, you know, the kids could eat a bit later, and my husband was around a bit more, and I said, okay, we need to merge food, but I knew that he wasn't going to deal with eating sausage and mash every night or whatever it was. You know, we had to do something more.
Yeah.
So I'd make a lentil salad or a quinoa salad or, you know, some roasted broccoli or whatever and have it on the table, thinking, I've no idea if the children are going to eat this or not. And actually, when they had the option of picking a bit out and putting it on their plate, they did try it.
So it's presenting it, even if you don't think it will be tried. And having that patience, I think that you've really like hit something there with me, because I think it's... You offer something, they try it, and then they're like, no. And you think, well, that's that then. Won't bother with that again. And it's having that patience to go, do you know what? Keep putting that down in front of them. Keep going. Keep trying little steps and take your time. You don't need that instant, brilliant, now my child's eating these exotic dishes.
You know, it's a big, big thing. And, you know, there is this sort of adult palate is very different from a child's palate.
Yeah, yeah.
But also children do like tasty food as well.
Mm.
Remember, the really popular new foods, the things like crisps, you know, chilli and all sorts of sort of salsa flavoured and really cheesy, because they've added all these extra flavour. So actually people, it's always like the kids are being bombarded with taste these days. So again, you need to sort of, in some kids you need to step it up. So a lot of kids like curries and strong tasting food. Maybe they don't like the actual hot chili, but they like the cumin and the corianders and things. So my eldest doesn't particularly like avocado, but he loves guacamole.
Okay.
So it's finding a different way of getting it in. And the same with carrots. My brother never ate cooked carrots, but he liked raw carrots.
Mm-hmm.
And so, but he was still getting carrots, you know, at the end of the day. So it doesn't really matter if they have it in a form. And it's thinking, how else can I present this? And this is why, you know, getting the courgette and the brownies is a way of getting courgette in. And it's not perfect.
But it's going in.
But it's going in, exactly.
And
one
develop.
Day, their taste buds will just, you know, that slight hint of courgette will slowly allow them to like it eventually. And again, you might just, and it's taking them out for meals, it's going to family, it's shaking things up, and them having different exposures to different things. Because so often, so whenever they go to their grandma's, they eat the full Sunday roast, no fuss.
Yeah.
But at home, they won't touch a carrot.
Mm.
And you're thinking, you know, let's do that more.
Yeah. Yeah.
And also getting other kids over.
Yeah.
Going to other people's houses for tea.
Mm.
I think being social is really key.
On that note, different people have different rules, and children go to parties from tiny ages now. They have the little kids' parties, and of course sweets come up, and chocolates and sweet treats, and I know most parents, I think, do try to really keep an eye on that and are careful, way more these days, because we know that they're really bad for them. But how much is too much? What is okay? Because I don't think making it a completely forbidden thing is helpful, because the second they can, they're gonna, it's the forbidden fruit, isn't it?
Absolutely. I agree.
How do you balance that?
So what you need to sort of gauge your child, because some kids, as I said, aren't that sensitive to sugar, you know, and they're kind of, they come back and they're pretty chilled, and they don't have poor immune systems, and they don't have behavioral issues, and sort of like, well, you know what? They have one party every 3 months.
Yeah.
Is that a big deal?
Yeah.
But when you've got a class of 30 and you've got a party every single weekend, and then I know, something else happening. You've got Halloween, you've got fireworks, you've got Christmas, Easter.
You've got grandparents coming round.
Exactly.
Going,
so sometimes it can get really out of hand.
Yeah.
So it's gauging the situation every single time, thinking, you know, not just today, but the week, looking at the whole week and thinking, you know, what... And so sometimes what I'd do is, say, give them a sandwich or something before we went, so they were relatively full.
Yeah.
So that
not
they
trying
didn't
to fill up on it.
Exactly.
Then.
Yeah. So then if they had a few crisps and a few sweet things, it was okay.
Yeah. Mm.
But also, you know, I think some parents are brilliant and they do incredible birthdays. But I've seen as the kids get older, the parents have got lazier.
Yeah.
So it's very often a hot dog and a white bun, packet of crisps, and a packet of Haribos and a bit of birthday cake.
Yeah.
Because they're out and about. They're at a soft play centre or, you know.
So it's a package deal, isn't it?
It
when
is.
You go to those places, they offer you a burger or a hot dog or nuggets and you have to tick a box.
Exactly. You think, no, I mean, that, you know, and actually we were out last, I don't know, you know, you've just got to gauge the situation, but you probably, and so if I know it's a mummy who's going to be doing a lovely, you know, proper
party spread.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
I think, yay, go for it.
Yeah.
But if I think it's a soft play option, I probably would feed them beforehand.
Feed them beforehand so that they're not too bothered about it.
Yes, exactly.
And then just make sure that they're few and far between.
Yeah, exactly. And I think, you know, as I said, you just need to go with the flow of it all.
Yeah.
And think, is this becoming the norm?
Mm.
And it depends where you live. You know, we live in the countryside, so generally we've had camping parties and it's all very hearty and outdoorsy.
Yeah. Yeah.
Whereas in London, it was all very much in soft play centres and, you know, sort of, or, you know, and you could just see it wasn't going to be as good quality.
Mm.
Yeah.
A question for you then on fussy eaters.
Yes.
And picky eaters, because so many parents have this right from baby age. And I personally do remember getting really upset when my eldest was rejecting, this is at puree stage, you know, rejecting thing after thing. And I kept trying everything. And I would get so upset and worried that he wasn't eating.
Mm.
He was perfectly healthy and growing fine. So he must have been taking on what he needed. But I know firsthand how stressful that can be.
Mm-hmm.
And on into childhood with fussy and picky eaters. What tips do you have for helping them, I mean, babies and through early childhood when they are fussy?
So it really depends, looking at the food, what they are rejecting.
Okay.
So, for instance, some just don't like the texture of puree. It feels funny.
Mm.
Often they end up being sensory kids. You find that often there is a sort of sensory issue, and they're very, you know, they're often the kids that don't sleep very well. Everything's a little bit, they're slightly find it difficult in crowds and noises. You can just sort of see that sort of baby on alert, and often, and with that, it's, you've got to say, well, actually, they're going to end up being crunchy kids because it serves them better.
Mm.
And so that's where they might go down the baby-led weaning route. But equally, you've got the other kids where they've often got very large tonsils.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe they don't start teething till much later on, so they haven't got enough teeth to chew.
Yeah.
So they've had a fear of swallowing, or, you know, felt like they were choking.
Mm-hmm.
So sometimes it just feels very awkward going down.
Mm-hmm.
A number of times I've seen children and they've literally got a hole like that big.
Aww.
Because their tonsils are quite inflamed.
Yeah.
They're not like, they haven't got tonsillitis, it's just everything's
just
a bit swollen.
Large. Yeah.
And then there's things like undetected tongue tie.
Yeah.
I've seen kids with you know, two, almost like two sets of teeth coming through at once.
Oh, wow.
You know, really, or very high palates.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, and you look at their tongue, you know, often with kids with Down syndrome, obviously their tongue's sticking out a lot.
Mm-hmm.
So you've got to respect your child's situation and look at that and think, is there something else going on? And that's what we do in our clinic. We have a good old check of the mouth and see what might be going on.
Yeah.
And I think that then once you know that, I think, okay, well, let's work on their immune system.
Yeah.
If their tonsils are inflamed, or what's triggering that? Is it a food intolerance? Is it a milk allergy?
Yeah.
What's triggering this inflammation in the mouth?
And if it's a texture thing, changing the texture,
yes,
I suppose, because I'm pretty sure with my son it was around the stage where we went to just the slightly lumpier, and that was a big problem. So
yeah, no, lumpy is a big problem for kids all across the board,
mm-hmm.
and that's why investing something like a NutriBullet,
mm-hmm.
because it really blends things up, could be very helpful, and that's where, and I think why all these pouches are perfect for the fussy eater, and it encourages the fussy eater because it's just so uniform.
Yeah.
The taste, the texture is the same every single time.
Mm.
And this is where it's not so much fun to begin. It's not so easy to begin with, but shaking it up and getting the odd lump in.
Yeah.
I know you don't mean to, but actually it's quite good in some ways
good.
As well.
Yeah,
to definitely. Realise that that's normal food. That's what real food's all about. And again, with the food, you know, things like the carrots or the kale or the broccoli, it's all got slightly bitter taste, and it's encouraging the different taste yeah. buds as well.
So actually some of that work you can put in at the beginning, in those early stages and weaning and experimenting with flavours and textures, probably would preempt the fussiness later on. You were quite likely to then have a less fussy child later if you can do that work at the beginning and not go down that path where they're, you know, you're cooking five meals to find one that they'll accept.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, there will be a stage almost in every child's life where they will become fussier. Mm. So often when they've had a course of, say, ear infections, their immune system's been low, they started at nursery, they dropped their nap at lunchtime, yeah. so they're a bit grouchy. Yeah. I mean, there are lots of reasons why kids won't eat. Mm. But it's realising, you know, I did do that groundwork. They yeah. did like it originally.
Yeah.
And how can I shake this up? How can I get more in somehow? Yeah. Yeah. They love eggs. Let's get it in, you know, a frittata yeah. or an omelette and make it very grated or whatever it might be just to hide it. And I just think you slowly get there. Mm-hmm. But it's to say it hasn't gone entirely.
Mm.
And then sometimes, as I said, it is the immune system. It's basically them saying, I'm just not feeling hungry right now. I always say, you know, when a child's come out of gastroenteritis, you know, they've had terrible norovirus or tummy upset. And all they want to have is yogurt or banana and crackers.
Yeah. Mm.
But then that can continue for months and months and months. Mm. And it's because their gut bacteria has been thrown out.
Mm-hmm.
So actually what we find so often is putting in a course of probiotic powders or yeah. little tablets
yeah.
are really, really helpful
okay.
at reverting that.
Brilliant.
Because once you get the good guys in,
yes.
those all build, you know, the everything feels more comfortable in the yeah. tummy, less acidic, and they're more likely to want their normal foods again. So we often find that just that simple
yeah.
step of a 6-week course of probiotics makes a big, big difference.
That's
to getting
amazing.
The fuss eater back to how they were before.
Amazing.
Mm.
Supplements generally, mm-hmm. what supplements are... Would you recommend? What supplements are good for little ones?
So
or
the only
what's not good?
So the only one that the government recommend is vitamin D,
mm-hmm.
And that's really from very young all the way through. And that's usually during the winter. Now, if they're on formula, then there is vitamin D added to the formula, so they won't need it if they're on formula. But if they're yeah. breastfed, then they will need vitamin D,
mm-hmm.
and that's sort of ongoing. Even you and I
yep.
need some vitamin D during
mm-hmm.
the winter.
Mm.
Another thing which is very important is omega-3, and you can start giving this from sort of weaning stage, say mm-hmm. 5-6 months. Obviously, if you are able to give them salmon
mm-hmm.
or some sardines or some, you know, oily fish or even flax seeds or chia seeds, then they're going to get the omega-3 in that way, which is fantastic. But a lot of people do struggle with that, or it's not a focus, like you end up with cod, which isn't oily. It might be fish, but it's not oily.
Yeah.
And so that's another important brain food, because the DHA is the thing that helps to form the brain, the eyes, and the central nervous system.
Mm-hmm.
So it's all really, really important.
From what age can you give the omega-3?
From about 5-6 months.
Okay.
Yeah, there are some which are a little bit earlier, but mm-hmm. I generally say around the time when you're weaning, because that's when you're introducing food.
Yeah.
So that's a good one to, you know, if you're, especially I think often people might not do it with their first child because they are not so aware, but often with the second child, they've realized, you know, had all these difficulties,
yeah.
and I don't want those difficulties to occur in my second.
Yeah.
But you know, obviously, I'd love the message to get through to the first people with their firstborn as well.
Yeah.
So those are really key. Some paediatricians do recommend multivitamins, but it really depends on your diet when you were pregnant. So if someone had terrible morning sickness, you know, some people have it the whole way through their pregnancy.
Yeah.
They've been throwing up, they haven't had good nutrition through.
Mm.
They might need a top up.
Yeah.
Or for instance, someone, you know, they themselves have food allergies or they have restrictions that, you know, like being vegan or vegetarian, they will need extras.
Yeah.
I think the iron thing is massively important.
Mm.
And that drops off naturally in a baby from about 6 months. So that's why it's okay. Again, really important to get them weaning. And if you've got a child that is struggling with their weaning, as they said, they might have a developmental issue or just, you know, a sensory issue or a reflux issue, then they might need some extra iron at that point. And again, that's something that we do in our team and can help with because that is it basically gets the oxygen to the brain and it helps with energy, it helps with sleep, it helps on all levels, it helps with growth.
Would you say then that's a good one to have regardless of how much is in the diet anyway?
Or no.
is it a case of...
Iron is one where it can, you can have overload can have as well. Mm. And there are, you have to look at your medical history.
Because that can then cause other complications, can't it? If you have too much. So
it's really where maybe there's a history of anemia in the family, mm-hmm. where maybe you've chosen to go down the vegan or vegetarian path.
Yeah.
Where maybe, there's a high risk. You know, you've had a loss of blood when a hemorrhage or something when you're giving birth.
Yeah.
So there's all those things that are, you know, important to take into consideration. That's why I think it's important to speak to a professional.
Yeah.
And that's what our NatureDoc team can do.
Amazing.
And what we tend to do is we tend to set up a one-hour consultation to begin with, which can be Skype, so that the mum's at home, they don't have to move anywhere. And then we tend to then say, well, let's chat every couple of weeks or 3 weeks, depending on the situation.
Mm.
Just even if it's just for half an hour to check they're heading in the right direction and everyone's happy. And we sort of do that baby support all the way through.
That's fantastic. Mm. I wish I'd found you when I had my first. I really do, because I think it would have changed a lot of things that I struggled to find answers on. So good to have somebody like you in our world. It really, really is. And like I said, I can't wait to get stuck into your book more so. I'm going to get my youngest cooking with me.
Yeah, have really fun doing that in the kitchen. It's great. And I know it's messy.
But that's okay. Especially when you have got the time and you're not rushing to and from school and things like that.
So the holidays are great. And I think weekends and holidays are where you can really max. And if you've got a fussy eater, that is the best time to make changes.
Definitely. I feel reassured. It's never too late.
Never too late. Now, remember, a child's brain is still developing until their mid-20s.
Amazing.
So it's never too late to feed them the good stuff.
Yes.
Yay.
Thank you so, so much for talking with me today. I've learned loads and I hope that lots of other people are going to find so many benefits from this conversation and replay it over and over again, because there's so many nuggets in there of amazing, amazing knowledge. Thank you so much, Lucinda.
I've absolutely loved meeting you too, Lucy. It's been great. And I hope that we can, you know, share each other's knowledge and sort of learn from each other.
Definitely.
And then make sure that more and more babies are sleeping through the night.
Absolutely.
And we have happier parents.
Yes. Definitely. Oh, thank you.